The 1970s was an essential time period for healing of the American racial ties. Following the Civil Rights Movement, understanding and acceptance of other races and cultures was limited. This time period was very important to the formation of modern American culture as a whole. Before this, there was a large disconnect between black and white culture. Music from this era was able to transcend cultural boundaries and popularize black culture among white Americans. The 1970s was an influential period for race relations in America, and the music from the time exemplifies how differing races and cultures could coexist.
Check out that Soul Train line now. The Soul Train gang to the music of Earth, Wind, and Fire and Mighty, Mighty.
During this time period, funk emerged as a popular genre of music. One of the major airways for this to be transmitted to America was through the very popular television show Soul Train. Soul Train was predominantly an African-American-led talk show with musical guests and celebrity appearances such as Parliament, Stevie Wonder, and James Brown. This television series was a window into African-American culture during the time period. The show started off with a largely black audience, but as it grew, the number of Caucasians that tuned in to watch the show grew, and seeing the African-American guests helped to give them a feel for the African-American culture at the time. This show helped to develop what funk music is and the culture surrounding it. One such pioneer in this genre was Parliament, who helped to further advance funk and the social impact it had on America as a whole.
One of Parliament's songs, Chocolate City, had a large social impact and explicitly referenced many issues within society. The popularity of Soul Train, combined with the realistic and socially conscious content from 70s black music, allowed for increased cultural understanding and decreased racial tensions between blacks and whites in America.
The music was very instrumental, and it helped the races connect during a time of bigotry and racism, said Sile Johnson, 77, who released the single Is It Because I'm Black in 1969. White parents wouldn't let the kids listen to the records by black artists, but they hid under the covers, listening to the songs on transistor radios, and when they grew up, bigotry disappeared. It's still here, but R&B and soul music was very, very instrumental in the bridging racial gaps between black and white. This quote perfectly illustrates the connection funk music made between black and white folks during the 1970s.
Funk music played an important role in cultural understanding. The song Chocolate City by Parliament is an example of this. And it also explicitly references racial issues from the point of view of a black American. In the song, Parliament's lead singer, George Clinton, talks about the racial injustice in American culture during its time. This is evident through many of the lyrics in the piece.
Oh, what's happening, CC?
Here, Clinton mentions CC, which stands for Chocolate City. And Chocolate City throughout the song is representative of Washington, D.C.
They still call it the White House, but that's a temporary condition too. Can you dig it, CC? To each his reach, and if I don't cop, it ain't mine to have. But I'll be reaching for you, cause I love you, CC. Right on. There's a lot of chocolate cities around. We've got Newark, we've got Gary. Somebody told me we got L.A. And we're working on Atlanta. But you're the capital city.
Hey, hello, yeah.
Clinton then discusses the growth of black culture and populations into cities, urban areas, and politics. The increasing African-American influence in society is conveyed when he mentions that the White House, being white, is a temporary condition. He is saying that the African-Americans are becoming more politically and socially relevant. Clinton then mentions different cities, specifically Gary, Newark, Los Angeles, Atlanta, and the Chocolate City, or Washington, D.C., that are becoming mainly populated by African-Americans. There was a study reported by Leah Boustin, a professor of economics at Princeton University, found that from the 1960s to 1970s, for every one black person that moved into these metropolitan areas, two white people retreated from the cities to the suburbs. Then, at the ending of the verse, the chorus comes in and repeats, "Gainin' on ya," which is referring to the universal growth of African American people and culture in American politics and urban areas.
Hey, CC! They say you jive and game and can't be changed. But on the positive side, you're my piece of the rock and I love you, CC. Can you dig it? Hey, we didn't get our 40 acres and a mule, but we did get you, CC. Yeah. Gaining on ya. Moving in around ya. God bless CC and his vanilla suburbs.
In the first stanza of this verse, Clinton addresses the Chocolate City and tells them that the general public says that their city is a jiving game and that it can't be changed, which refers to the discrimination that African Americans have faced in the past and in the 1970s. Then Clinton continues to say that Chocolate City is his side of the rock. The rock is in reference to America, and Clinton is saying that of all the cities in America that are predominantly African American, even though they are scrutinized and discriminated against, he is taking ownership of the situation they were given and accepting the bigotry.
Clinton continues to talk about how, despite their unfair treatment and segregation, Black Americans still found love and happiness in the world. He even says, God bless CC and its vanilla suburbs, insinuating that although Blacks had received extremely unfair treatment in society, they were still willing to love and accept others. When he says, we didn't get our 40 acres and a mule, Clinton is referencing history's racism, while also making a statement about unfair treatment in general. According to blackpast.org, the idea of the 40 acres and a mule exemplifies the federal government's failure to redistribute land after the Civil War and offer retribution for slavery and the economic hardship that African Americans suffered as a result. Clinton's historically accurate references to racism in a popular funk song resulted in increased awareness and understanding of Black culture and suffering by white Americans.
A blood to blood, players to ladies. The last percentage count was 80. You don't need the bullet when you got the ballot.
In verse 3, Clinton states you don't need the bullet when you got the ballot. This is a direct and clear reference to the speech that Malcolm X gave in Cleveland in 1964. In this speech, Malcolm X details his struggles with democracy and his opinion on how without standing up for themselves, African Americans will never get anything done. On the other hand, George Clinton says that violence is not the answer to our problems, but instead the solution is found through democracy and making sure that African Americans are voting for the people and the things that would make life better and easier for them, rather than continue the strain of discrimination that was taking place at the time of the song and Malcolm X's speech.
Are you up for the downstroke, CC?
In this next line, Clinton says, are you up for the downstroke, CC? This lyric is referring to a downstroke in a song. A downstroke is used at the beginning of a song, and Parliament asking all of their audience if they are up for the downstroke is essentially asking if they are ready for the beginning of something new, or a social revolution where African Americans become more prominent figures in society.
And when they come to march on you, tell them to make sure they got their James Brown pass. And don't be surprised if Ali is in the White House.
Here, Clinton mentions Muhammad Ali. Ali was one of the most influential African-American people of all time. He is often hailed as the greatest boxer of all time as well, which gave him a large platform to spread his messages. Clinton specifically suggests that Ali could become president of the United States. According to Rolling Stone magazine, Muhammad Ali was one of the first famous Americans to introduce the concept of black pride or black empowerment publicly, through his refusal to accept his slave name of Cassius Clay. Ali's huge societal impact proceeded to influence and inspire a new wave of music that favored Black Americans. Just a few years after Ali's name change, James Brown, who was also mentioned by Clinton in this verse, released a song which included the lyrics, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. At a similar time, Adam Clayton Powell Jr. and Stokely Carmichael became the first to publicly use the phrase, Black Power. The reference to Muhammad Ali as a leader in Chocolate City directly relates to Ali's significant role in the creation of black empowerment and African Americans finding their place in society.
James Brown was one of the most influential funk artists of all time. He's said to be the inventor of the modern funk sound. Funk is defined as a music genre that originated in the mid-1960s when African American musicians created a rhythmic, danceable new form of music through a mixture of soul music, jazz, and R&B. This style of music involved a lot more bass guitar compared to other music genres at the time and usually only used one or two musical riffs. This style of music was designed to be danced to, and while other genres were danceable, none stood a chance against the foot-tapping beats that funk provided. Along with this, James Brown used funk as a way of expressing his beliefs. Specifically, the song I'm Black and I'm Proud helped kickstart a black power movement. In fact, in 1967, African Americans were still referred to as Negroes. That was the term used by civil rights leaders, by the respectable middle class, and by white people who had some level of respect for their fellow man. Black was used, but it was far from the preferred term, and was sometimes used as an insult. By the late 60s, some efforts had been made to reclaim the word, but James Brown helped blow things wide open with those five words, "I'm black and I'm proud."
As uplifting as the language of the civil rights movement had been in the decade prior, the tone was one of equality. They worked to convey the message, we're as good as you, we're the same as you, we deserve the same treatment as you. Brown's ideas in his song were no less noble, but the tone was completely different. In this song, Brown loves being black. He's proud of who he is, and he portrays his race as something to celebrate, not as an obstacle to work around. What's more, Brown doesn't simply ask the listener to feel the same way, he insists on it.
Reverend Ike, Secretary of the Treasury. Richard Pryor, Minister of Education. Stevie Wonder, Secretary of Fine Arts.
Similar to Parliament, Stevie Wonder used his artistic ability to give social commentary. Living for the City, a hit single released in 1973 by Wonder, was one of the first soul singles to deal so explicitly with systematic racism in America.
At the start of the song, Stevie Wonder says that he was born in Hard Time, Mississippi. In fact, Mississippi committed the largest number of racially motivated crimes, including lynchings, during the 60s and 70s. Also, in 1998, there was a file that was uncovered from a state agency in Mississippi that used spy tactics in attempts to thwart civil rights activists in the late 60s and early 70s. The main idea of this committee was to keep segregation at any means necessary. When Dudley Connor, a lawyer for the Sovereignty Committee, was asked about Clyde Kennard, who was trying to desegregate Mississippi Southern College, Connor said, if the Sovereignty Commission wanted that Negro out of the community and out of the state, they would take care of that situation. When asked to clarify what he meant, Connor said, Kennard's car could be hit by a train, or he could have some accident on the highway, and nobody would ever know the difference. Kennard later was framed for having 5 pints of whiskey and other bottles of liquor in his car and was sentenced to prison, then shortly died after of cancer. This represents the hard times for African Americans in the time that this song was written, as the Mississippi government would not give African Americans a chance to change things as they continuously made efforts to stop African Americans from gaining more rights and promote desegregation.
Wonder goes on to tell the story of a young boy from Mississippi who migrates to the Big Apple. At home, he faced hardships such as poverty and harsh living conditions, but was loved by his parents. They were heavily discriminated against. Despite these challenges, Wonder also describes how they worked hard, walked long distances to school, and were always sure to look the best they can. This depiction of a hard-working family being held back by only their skin color would have likely given white people at the time a new perspective and helped to stop racism in America. Furthermore, African Americans were discriminated against in the workforce. In the song, Wonder refers to the economic racism commonly found in the South. He discusses the difficulty blacks faced when trying to find jobs, along with the unfair pay that those employed actually received. This was an undeniable characteristic of America at the time, as the national black unemployment rate was nearly double that of the white unemployment rate.
His sister's black, but she is shown the pretty. Her skirt is short, but Lord, her legs are sturdy. To walk to school, she's got to get up early. Her clothes are old, but never are they dirty.
Stevie Wonder continues by telling the story of a boy once he finally achieved his goal of reaching New York. Unfortunately, many of the same problems he experienced in Mississippi persisted, and he was arrested for a crime he did not commit, and was sentenced to 10 years in prison, essentially due to his blackness alone. This story highlighted the racism and injustice that was all too common in the US during the time. Stevie Wonder's huge popularity made most people aware of this harsh reality and helped to repair race relations. It was necessary for whites to hear firsthand accounts of the horrible experiences of black people for societal changes to be made. Wonder used his newfound influence to portray the bleakness of black situation in America through his music. In this way, Stevie Wonder worked alongside other musicians such as Parliament to create awareness and heal racial divides in the 1970s. This also opened the door for white folks to understand the racism at the time and to heal the racial rift created through the injustices of segregation and the Jim Crow laws.
In conclusion, the 1970s was a very important time for American race relations and signified a healing of the wounds created during segregation and the Jim Crow days. Post-Civil Rights America saw drastic changes in the acceptance and understanding of the life of black Americans at the time. Musicians such as Parliament and Stevie Wonder used the newly created funk genre as a catalyst for these changes. Specifically, Parliament's song Chocolate City is a good example of the way music can reflect the social issues of its time, with many lines directly referencing important figures from the time, such as James Brown and Muhammad Ali. These individuals used the Black Power movement to further the work done by civil pioneers such as Martin Luther King. This saw a cultural shift in the way others viewed black people and how black people saw themselves. Along with this, Stevie Wonder gave us a glimpse into the hard life lived by a colored person and the daily injustices they felt. All of these different influences, along with the television and media like Soul Train, gave white America an insight to the black culture and resulted in a better understanding of it. In all, the 1970s was an influential period for race relations in America, and the music from the era exemplified how different races and cultures could coexist.